week I met this brother right here at Todd R. Post, right? Todd R., amen. And he's a friend of Ken's, and I met him last week, and he does some posted some stuff on Facebook and showed us up all as being lit and high in the Holy Ghost, amen. Took pictures and things, and they said, there's a pastor, he's riding high, amen. Hallelujah, but it's good, amen. And then he posted, he had about a nine-minute testimony, I think it was, that you posted on there, a video. And so I watched, and I said, man, that's good. So I got in touch with him, and I said, I want you to come share some of your testimony tonight, amen. Todd, come on up here, amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you, man. Amen. Go ahead and take a little time to share your testimony.
Praise the Lord. Have my Bible handy just in case the Lord leads me to look up a scripture. Because even though I love to get drunk on the new wine, we can't neglect the word. Amen. Before I get into my testimony, I feel led to share something in particular. I like that little paddle you have that says, stir it up. And it reminded me of that scripture in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6, which says to stir up the gift of God that's in you. Now, if you know your Bible, then you should remember that the next verse, it says what? Anybody know what 2 Timothy 1, 7 says? God has not given us what? But of what? Power, love, and a sound mind. Well, I'm sure a lot of you know that the chapter and verse numbers stuck in the Bible, they did not appear in the original Hebrew and Greek text. They were added by the translators to help us look up particular scriptures. But a lot of times it's helpful to look at verses together because we may see something we never did before. If we just read one passage of scripture but don't look at the verse before it or after that, we miss something. So I find it interesting, in 2 Timothy 1:6, it says to stir up the gift of God, but then the next verse says God has not given us a spirit of fear. And it occurred to me perhaps one of the reasons why a lot of us are fearful or not confident in our relationship with the Lord is we're neglecting our gifts. You know, it says in a previous epistle that Paul wrote to Timothy, I think it's in 1 Timothy 4:14, it says do not neglect the gift of God. But then it says in 2 Timothy 1:6 to stir up the gifts. So Paul was reminding Timothy to stir up the gifts that are in him. And so my prayer is that my testimony tonight will inspire you to stir up your gifts. Because God has given every one of you gifts, natural gifts and spiritual gifts. And it doesn't matter what you've done in the past. You know, it's really sad that if a pastor or a minister has a moral failure, there are leaders that want to remove him from the pulpit. But it says in Romans 11:29 that the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. They are without repentance. So it doesn't matter how bad you messed up in the past. If you repented, God can restore you and bring you back to the place that he wants you to be. And so I'm going to take a few minutes to share with you my testimony, how I found the Lord, or how the Lord found me, however you want to look at it, and how God has opened up doors for me, opportunities to use the gifts that he has blessed me with. I was born on January 13th, 1964, in Fargo, North Dakota, and every time I mention Fargo, usually people think of that movie, Fargo, right? Now, normally, I don't watch rated R movies, but a couple years ago, I was staying with a man who happened to have the DVD, so I decided to watch it because it's got the name of my birthplace on there. And I don't know if a lot of you know this, but none of that movie was actually filmed in Fargo. If you've seen the movie, you might remember the opening scene. It shows this bar. I think it's called King of Clubs. That's actually in Northeast Minneapolis. Even though in the movie said it was in Fargo, that's actually Northeast Minneapolis. I used to drive by that place when I lived in Minneapolis for a while. But anyway, I was born in Fargo, North Dakota, and I grew up in the bordering city of Moorhead, Minnesota. It's their border cities. And as a kid, yep, every time I say I'm Minnesota, people think I have an accent. In fact, I didn't realize I had an accent until I started coming down to Florida. People recognize. Anyway. So I grew up in Minnesota, and as a kid, I had dreams of writing and producing electronic music. That was a dream of mine ever since I was a kid. Back in the 1970s, you might remember, the music stores often sold these electronic organs. This is before synthesizers became more affordable. They had like the preset rhythms and the different sounds. I remember as a little kid when my parents took my sister and I shopping, I always like going to the music store, and until the manager would kick me off, I'd try and create my own songs on these organs. And I'd often ask my dad if he would buy me an organ. And his usual response was, learn to play the piano first, and then maybe we'll get you the organ. Well, since there was no guarantee that I would get an organ if I took piano lessons, that didn't inspire me to take piano lessons. In fact, I never took a piano lesson until I was 19. But nevertheless, music always remained a dominant interest throughout my childhood. By the time I got into my teens, I started buying records. I became a faithful listener of American Top 40. Anybody remember that show with Casey Kasem? By the time I was 14, I was a regular listener of that show. I would faithfully write down the top songs of the week. You might remember 1978, the Bee Gees hit it big with Saturday Night Fever. The Bee Gees actually became my favorite group the year before, so it was exciting for me to hear the Brothers Gibb dominating the music scene. And that helped sustain me during the most difficult year I ever had growing up. Throughout my childhood, I was constantly picked on. Some of you might remember when you were in grade school, there was usually one or two kids that got picked on more than others. I was one of those kids. And my dad would always tell me to say, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me. How many of you heard that phrase before? How many of you know that's unscriptural? That's right, it's a lie. Because what does Proverbs 18:21 say? Death and life and the power of the tongue. The words we speak over people can either build them up or tear them down. And because I heard a lot of negative words from my classmates, I became a loner. Eighth grade was by far my worst year in school. The name calling and the physical abuse that I endured, it made school basically a living hell for me. And I had serious thoughts about committing suicide. If my father had a gun, I probably would have shot myself. Fortunately, I didn't follow through on doing that. So before I started ninth grade, I did a lot of praying, even though I didn't know the Lord back then. And to my surprise, ninth grade went much better than eighth grade. I still experienced some teasing, but it wasn't as intense as the year before. Still, I got tired of having a negative reputation in school. I wanted to be accepted. I wanted to be popular. And so I was determined to find some way to have a social life apart from school. Well, in the fall of 1979, I decided to take up roller skating. This was about the time the disco craze had started waning a little bit, but a lot of people were taking up roller skating. My sister and a friend of hers, they started going out to this local roller rink. I started going out there, and I really liked it there. I thought, well, hey, I'm too young to get into the discotheques, but this would be the next best way for me to experience Saturday Night Fever. And as my roller skating skills improved, so did my confidence in asking girls to skate with me during couples only. And I soon noticed that the employees at this roller rink, name of the rink, Skateland, by the way, in Fargo, I noticed the Skateland employees were almost like celebrities to the regular skaters there. And so I knew if I got a job there, hey, that would really be cool, you know? So I started pestering the managers for a job there. And eventually I was offered a job there. I first started working behind the skate counter, passing out roller skates, and also had to clean up the messes made by the skaters. But eventually I got to work as a floor guard. They're the ones that skate around, enforcing the rules, helping skaters that have fallen down. And more importantly for me, I got to play the records. It was my first paying disc jockey job. So with the current hit songs playing in the background and a lot of people knowing me on a first name basis, I had a great time working there. But I remember shortly after I started working at Skateland, I still sensed there was something missing. It was around this time one of my girlfriends had invited me to attend a meeting put on by this organization called Young Life. How many here ever heard of Young Life? It's a Christian organization. I think it's similar to Youth for Christ, Campus Life. I went to my first Young Life meeting, and I was surprised because Back then, I had some negative perceptions of Christianity. When I was growing up, my parents took my sister and I to a Lutheran church that was very traditional. And deep down in my heart, I wanted to believe in God, but he just wasn't real to me there. We didn't go to church that much as a family. Usually my dad would take my sister and I, drop us off for Sunday school, and then pick us up an hour later. If we went to church as a family, it just wasn't a real positive experience. I had a hard time just sitting still in these hard wooden pews, listening to this old organ music and these sermons that put you to sleep practically. And I even remember as a kid, I was looking forward to becoming an adult just so I wouldn't have to go to church. But I remember after I went through confirmation, God started reaching out to me through other people. And one of the people the Lord tried to use was one of my girlfriends at the roller rink. I went to my first Young Life meeting, and I was a bit surprised because here was a group of Christians that looked like they knew how to have a good time. You know, they would not only sing songs, they'd also put on skits. And I went to a few more Young Life meetings. This would have been the spring of 1981. I was 17 at the time. And a short time later, I found out that our Young Life group was going to be going to this summer camp called the Castaway Club. It's in central Minnesota near Detroit Lakes. And I remember at that time it cost $142 to go to Castaway. Well, I didn't have much money back then. But I remember my Young Life leader, his name's Bill, he called me up about 2 weeks before Castaway came up, or before our group was supposed to go there. And he asked me if I was going. I said, well, I kind of liked it, but I don't really have the money. He said, how much money do you have on you right now? And I said, I got about $50. He said, we'll let you go to Castaway for $50. And I was surprised. You know, I thought, well, let me think about it. Well, there was actually some record albums I wanted to buy, so I went ahead and spent my money on there. And when he called me back, I think it was the next day or two, I told Bill that I decided not to go to Castaway. I went ahead and spent some of my money. So then he asked me, how much money do you have left? And I said, oh, about $25. He said, we'll let you go to Castaway for $25. I said, what? He said, we'll let you go to Castaway for $25. So I thought, well, I'm not going to pass up a bargain. So I went to Castaway for $25. And it was a pretty good time. But I remember the last night I was there, there was a minister who basically explained that God cannot hear your prayers unless you have Jesus in your heart. And I thought to myself, well, certainly I want God to hear my prayers. So I stood up along with a few other young people and I asked Jesus Christ to be my Lord and Savior. Back then, I didn't fully recognize the importance of what I'd just done, but Bill was sure excited. This is why he let me come to Castaway for $25. And not long afterwards, Bill started having a Bible study in his apartment, he and his wife. But I only went to this Bible study just because he kept asking me. I still had negative perceptions of Christianity. It was also around this time that there were two preachers from Minnesota named Dan and Steve Peters, the Peters brothers. Anybody heard of them? Back in the early 1980s, they had gotten some national recognition with their rock music seminars. They would show album covers and song lyrics. They'd point out how a lot of secular rock music goes against Scripture. And during these seminars, it would often conclude with young people burning their records. And I remember them saying, I went to a couple of their seminars, and I remember they would say, you should only listen to Christian rock or gospel music only. Well, back in 1981, most of the Christian music I heard, I didn't like, because it sounded years behind what was coming out in the secular market. And so I thought to myself, well, if I have to be a good little Christian by listening to this wimpy stuff all day long, forget it. And there were other things that drew me away from the Lord. Some of my coworkers at Skateland were into drinking. And initially, as a kid, I vowed not to drink alcohol because I was taught that it's a drug that should be avoided. But soon I wanted to party with my friends. And then when I got into my 20s, I started going to nightclubs because I wanted to meet more women my age. And I started drinking beer more often. And soon I was enjoying getting drunk on a regular basis. Well, after graduating from high school in 1982, I enrolled at Morehead State University, initially as a computer science major. But halfway through my first quarter in school, I found out the school's music department had an electronic music studio with synthesizers and multi-track tape recorders. Finally, this was an opportunity for me to pursue my lifelong dream of writing and producing my own electronic music. So I started signing up for classes in the electronic music department, which gave me access to the studio equipment. And in 1984, I decided to get serious about a music career. I put together my first demo tape. I eagerly sent out tapes to record companies. I thought all I needed was one label to like my music enough to sign me to a contract. I would have a hit song and become rich and famous. Well, how many know the music business is not an easy one to break into? You guys know. My demo tape got a lot of rejections. And it was also around this time Prince hit it big with Purple Rain. Minneapolis is a little over 200 miles from Moorhead, and soon I started desiring to move to Minneapolis. But I felt I wasn't financially and in some ways emotionally prepared to move to a bigger city. Well, in the beginning of 1985, I was at a nightclub one night, and I ran into a fellow who had briefly dated my sister. Found out this guy had enlisted in the Army National Guard, and he had suggested I do the same. Well, up until then, I had no interest in the military. I dreaded the thought of some drill sergeant yelling at me all the time. But one day, I decided to go down to the recruiting office to find out more information, and I found out that because I had some college under my belt, I found out that I wasn't able to enlist as a private first class, E3, which would entitle me to higher pay than most of the other recruits. And so I decided, and I was also desperate to get out of the Fargo-Moorhead area. I didn't want to live there anymore. So I decided to enlist in the military, in the Army National Guard, and I would save up most of the money that I received during basic and AIT, and it would prepare me for my move to Minneapolis. So I did basic training at Fort Jackson, South Carolina, in the spring of 1985. You been there? Were you in the Army? Interesting. So after I completed basic, I went to my AIT. First, I went to the Redstone Arsenal near Huntsville, Alabama. It was supposed to be a four-month school, but I found out halfway through my schooling, I discovered my recruiter screwed up. I made it clear to him before I enlisted that I was planning to move to Minneapolis after AIT, and I wanted to hook up with a guard unit in the Twin Cities area. Recruiters don't always tell the truth, I'm sorry to say. At least the one that enlisted me in the military. So make a long story short, I switched my MOS. I was transferred to Fort Gordon, Georgia, where I was certified as a wire systems installer operator. And I remember while I was in Fort Gordon, there was one of my platoon members kept telling me to get God in my life. It was another person God was trying to use to draw me closer to him. I resisted going to church on the military base. My grandparents would also write letters, try to encourage me to go to church with a colored person. Now, back then, there weren't too many African Americans in the Fargo-Moorhead area. That's totally changed now. There's a lot more. It's become a more diversified area. Well, after I completed AIT, I finally moved to Minneapolis, and I was eager to pursue a music career. With the money that I'd saved up during my military time, I bought a synthesizer and a four-track cassette recorder, and I spent a lot of my free time making demo tapes. The first 9 months I lived in the Twin Cities area, I had my car towed 3 times for various parking violations. And the third time made me so mad, I was determined to think of a way to get back at the towing companies. So I ended up writing and recording this song called Let's Blow Up the Tow Truck. When I started playing this song for people, everybody loved it. But I couldn't get the local radio stations to play it at first, and the record companies resisted releasing it. But a lot of people thought it was a funny song, so as a last resort, I sent it to a disc jockey named Dr. Demento. How many here have heard of Dr. Demento? For those of you who don't know who he is, Dr. Demento is a radio DJ. He has a syndicated radio program. He plays all kinds of funny music by Spike Jones, Cheech and Chong. A lot of you probably heard of Weird Al Yankovic, right? That's how Weird Al got discovered, was initially by having his music played on Dr. Demento's show. So I sent a tape of my tow truck song to Dr. Demento. He liked it, started playing it on his show, and it instantly became a requested favorite on his show. He used to have this countdown called the Funny Five, his top 5 requests of the week. Tow truck was up there many times, went number 1 in the spring of 1987. So you could basically say I had the hottest novelty song in the country. But despite the success it was having on Doctrine and Metal, I still couldn't get a recording contract. I sent the tape of the song to over 40 different record companies. Not one of them offered to release it. And the local radio stations in Minneapolis still resisted playing it. I remember a couple of the big stations told me they would play my tow truck song when the snow hits. Because that's when they tow a lot of cars after a major snowstorm. They declare a snow emergency. And if your car is parked where it's not supposed to be, you got to make a trip down to the impound lot. Well, the winter of 1987 was so mild, not once did the city of Minneapolis declare a snow emergency. And as I look back at it now, I believe that was divine intervention. Because had my song taken off and become the really big hit I thought it could be, it would have been harder to recognize my need for the Lord. So in the meantime, I was working as a disc jockey, initially in roller rinks. I worked at a few more rinks in the Twin Cities area. But then I focused more on nightclub work because it paid better. I liked playing more disco, funk, techno-type music. And one of the reasons I became a DJ was I thought the job could never get boring because there's always new music coming out. But during the late 1980s, the drinking age in Minnesota went up from 19 to 21. And I noticed that a lot of people, as they get older, they tend to want to hear the music they grew up with. And I hated playing oldies as a DJ. I mean, you get tired of hearing the same old songs every night. Money, 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 money. You shook me all night long. Among other ones. So with that, plus putting up with alcoholics and smoke-filled rooms, by the end of the 80s, I no longer desired working as a DJ. And so at the beginning of 1990, I decided I was going to try to find some other way to earn money. And by this time, I was willing to consider work outside the music business. Well, ironically, it was through another DJ, a radio DJ, that I got involved in a network marketing company called New Skin. Have you heard of that company? Back in 1990, this company was experiencing exponential growth. There were several distributors that were making large amounts of money. And so I decided to temporarily put my music career on hold. I sold off most of my equipment and became a New Skin distributor. My goal was to build a residual income to where I could pay off my bills and then at some point go back to my music when I wouldn't have to be concerned about my music paying the bills because I would have this residual income coming in. Well, my New Skin business did not prosper me financially, but in my pursuit of trying to build a successful business, I went through a lot of personal growth. I started going to seminars, listening to motivational tapes, and I kept hearing about how important it was to have your priorities in order. To be a successful person in life, you must put your spiritual goals first, next your family, and then your business. Every time I heard the spiritual part, this thought crossed my mind about going back to church, which for a while I resisted because I thought of the Lutheran church I went to as a kid, and I thought, I don't want to go through that again. But then in January of 1991, I was out at a nightclub celebrating my 27th birthday. I met a woman there who I took an interest in. We started seeing each other. And one day she asked me if I wanted to go to church with her. I said, sure. So we went to this non-denominational church called Living Earth Christian Center. It's in Brooklyn Park, Minnesota. It's pastored by Matt Hammond. Maybe some of you have heard of him. And I remember one of the things that Pastor Max said is, if this is your first time here, please make a decision to come back a second time and a third time to take a more accurate measure of us as a church. And I thought, well, that's only fair. So I went to Pastor Max's church a couple more times, but I still resisted the altar call. I was still reluctant to give my life to God. And one of the reasons that was keeping me away from Christianity was the desire for sex. Up until that time, I was living a very promiscuous lifestyle. But I soon realized that some of the decisions I was making in life was getting me into trouble. And finally, it was in mid-March of 1991, I finally realized I needed to get my life right with God. But I was still a bit reluctant to talk to someone at Living Word, because prior to that time, I'd never been to a full gospel church before. But I knew my sister and her husband were committed Christians, so I decided to have a talk with them. I drove up to Fargo, where they still live. And for over 3 hours, they cleared up many misunderstandings that I had about Christianity. I realized that it's not so much a religion, but it's a relationship. And eventually, my brother-in-law asked me if I wanted to pray. And I said, sure. So he led me in the prayer of salvation. I asked Jesus to come back into my heart. And when I did that, it felt like a surge of electricity flowed through my body. All this guilt that I was feeling suddenly lifted. God made himself real to me. I later found out that my sister and husband prayed for years that I would recognize my need for Jesus. They also prayed that I would meet a woman who would get me back into church. And they even prayed that they would play a part in my salvation. How many of you know God answers prayer? So if you have lost loved ones, don't give up on them. Keep praying for them. Acts 16:31 says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your... Amen. Well, it was about a year later, the Lord spoke to me in a dream to get out of my network marketing business. And so for the next 4 years, I bounced around from job to job. I was trying to find my place in the workforce, but it seemed like nothing was working out long term. Well, the Lord revealed to me at the end of 1995 that I was called to full-time ministry. And by that time, it made sense because I was already doing the work of an evangelist. About the same time I gave my life to the Lord in 1991, there was a friend of mine by the name of Steve. He got saved about the same time I did. And almost immediately, he got involved in our church's evangelism ministry. Every Monday night, our church would send teams of two or three people out on the streets of Minneapolis, sharing the gospel one-on-one and leading multitudes of people to the Lord. The church also would do special Wednesday night outreaches during the summer. They would cancel one Wednesday night service a month in an effort to get more people out on the streets sharing their faith. I went out a few Wednesday nights, but I mainly just watched and prayed. I let the team leader basically do all the talking. But then in the beginning of 1994, Steve started inviting me to come out on the streets with him, and he kept doing this over and over. Well, I knew this was God speaking to him, speaking through him, because the Lord already put it on my heart that I needed to share my faith more. But the first few times I went out on Monday night, I felt awkward trying to talk to total strangers about the Lord. But then a turning point happened in June of 1994. I had another friend of mine who was born again, but he was blind. And periodically I would share healing scriptures with him because I wanted to see my friend receive his sight. Unfortunately, he hung on to some religious beliefs that were inconsistent with scripture. One of them was he didn't think it was God's will to heal everyone. And so one Monday afternoon, I was at his house, and suddenly he just told me that he wanted to end our friendship. And I knew the real reason was because of our doctrinal differences. But when I insisted he tell me why he was terminating our friendship, he said, well, I just think you're too self-centered. I didn't argue with him, started walking out of his house, and then I got to thinking, just in case there's some truth to what he's saying, let's do something about that. Let's go out on the streets. Because one of the greatest things about street evangelism, it helps get your mind off yourself and you focus on the needs of other people. If you think you're having a bad day, go out and share your faith. And more than likely, God's going to send somebody across your path that have it a lot worse than you do. Because there's a lot of hurting people out there, brothers and sisters. There's people that are going through drug problems, family issues. Well, anyway, I was at this guy's house, which was only a couple miles from the church. So I went straight to the church because there was an evangelism outing that was going to begin in a half hour, and I was determined to be a soul winner. And that night, for the very first time, I led a stranger to the Lord. I went out on the streets again two nights later. It was a special Wednesday night outreach. That night, I got to lead five people to the Lord, one of whom was a guy that I'd gone to grade school with in Moorhead, who I hadn't seen in over 10 years. He had just moved to Minneapolis, found out he was raised Catholic, but he wasn't sure if he was going to heaven when his life ended. So I shared the gospel with him. He got born again. To God be the glory. I went out on the streets again the following Monday. That night, I got to lead 14 people to the Lord. And soon it came clear to me God wanted me to do the work of an evangelist. In fact, I remember when the weather started turning colder later that year, I was thinking about cutting back on my evangelism outings. But every time I thought about skipping Monday night evangelism, somebody would usually approach me the day before and ask me if I was going out on the streets. Usually nobody asked me this if I already made a firm decision to go out evangelizing. Well, in early 1995, I became a team leader and started training other Christians how to effectively present the gospel to people and lead many of them to the Lord. And it was at the end of the year the Lord showed me that he was calling me to full-time ministry. And not long afterwards, he instructed me to work for a man named Billy Graham. Anybody here heard of Billy Graham? At the time, his ministry headquarters was in Minneapolis, and I was hired to work in his film ministry, Worldwide Pictures. My job there was calling pastors of churches around the country, mentioning the latest evangelistic films that we had available, and encouraging them to show it in their churches as part of an outreach event. I did very well with this job. I quickly became one of their top salespeople. But a few months after I started working there, I faced a major test of faith. By this time, the Toronto Blessing was happening up in Toronto, Canada. And prior to that time, I made one trip there back in November of 1995. God sent me there for a healing conference, and I was thinking about going back to Toronto again sometime. Well, make a long story short, God instructed me to make a trip to Toronto in August of 1996. And initially, I was questioning it being direction from the Lord because I'd just taken a vacation a couple weeks before, and I thought, this is too soon to be asking for time off again. Well, God kept giving me confirmations that he wanted me to go to Toronto. So one day I came into work and I started filling out a time off request. And then the Lord spoke to me and said, you're going to have to resign from your job to make this trip. Initially, I thought it was the devil harassing me. So I just ignored the thought, finished the time off request, submitted to my supervisor. A couple days later, I was told that my time off request would be denied. But God kept telling me, I still want you to go to Toronto that week. Well, I had an important decision to make. Was I going to obey man or obey God? Well, I wanted to make sure that I would leave there on good terms, so I had a talk with my supervisor's supervisor. Turned out he didn't know what was going on, so I explained the situation to him, and he told me, well, Todd, we're sad to see you leave, but if God's telling you to do something, you better do it. So on my way to Toronto, the Lord spoke to me and said that I'd be going back there a third time. And I was surprised. I didn't even arrive there for my second visit, and God's already speaking to me about going a third time. So I went to Toronto for a week, then came back to Minneapolis, and I sought direction from the Lord, and eventually he clarified that he wanted me to live in Toronto for 2 months. There was a lot of inner healing that he needed to do from all the rejection I experienced growing up. So in October of 1996, I left Minneapolis with $120. I had no idea where I was going to live because at the time I didn't really know anybody in Toronto. But I knew I was supposed to live there for 2 months. Make a long story short, God eventually led me to a place to live for free. And I learned to trust God daily to meet my needs. Most of the time I had little or no money on me, but yet God would put on people's hearts to bless me with food or offer to take me out to eat. Whenever my gas tank was low, someone would offer to fill it up with gas. And it was also while I was in Toronto, God spoke to me about going to Germany. After I came back to Minnesota, God told me he wanted me to first go back to work at Billy Graham. So I got my old job back, worked there for another year, and then I had to step down again because God was telling me to go to Germany. I submitted another time off request, but again, they denied it. But yeah, people started giving me money to go to Germany. I did not ask anybody for a dime. Scripture that has been a blessing to me, it's in Psalm 37:25, says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging bread. If God wants you to do something, he'll bring the provision to you without trying to force it out of people. In 1998, I made two trips to Germany. Both times, I did not send out any support letters, but people gave me money to go to Germany. And those first two trips were really to spy out the land. I did a lot of sightseeing and just found out what it's like to live in Germany, basically. Eventually, I came back to Minneapolis. I did one more stint at Billy Graham. This time, they put me on a part-time basis, because by this time, God was having me do a lot more street evangelizing, not just through my church, but also on my own during the day. And then in January of 1999, I perceived that there was a major change that was about to take place in my life. So the final week of that month, I went on a fast, and it was at the end of that fast, the Lord showed me he wanted me to leave Billy Graham for good and move to Pensacola, Florida. By this time, the Brownsville revival was in full swing. We saw a video from one of the services not too long ago. Well, God gave me this direction late Friday afternoon, and he was wanting me to leave for Pensacola the following Tuesday, which meant I had to give my employer a 1 day's notice. I came into work Monday morning, and I told my supervisor, I said, hey, I'm sorry, this is too short a notice, but I believe the Lord wants me leaving for Pensacola tomorrow. Well, I found out that my position was about to be eliminated. Because the part-time people were calling accounts that either never booked a film before, it'd been years since they've done, so all the warm leads were given to the full-time people. And since the part-time people were not generating enough sales, enough revenue for the company, they just decided to eliminate the part-time positions altogether. So for me, it was a confirmation that my season at Billy Graham was over. But I still didn't have the money to go to Pensacola. I packed up my stuff by faith, not knowing how I was going to get down there. And then within a 12-hour period, three different people gave me money totaling over $100. I didn't ask them to help me out. They just said, hey, this is for your trip to Pensacola. So I came down to Pensacola in 1999. I went to a lot of the Brownsville Revival meetings. I believe God had me spend time there to soak up the anointing that was there. And by this time, I was starting to do a lot more evangelizing in Pensacola. And eventually, God started sending me to other cities throughout the United States. In 2003, I finally got to go back to Germany. Thought it would be a short trip, but I ended up staying in Europe for 5 months. I ministered throughout Germany, as well as in Austria, the Netherlands, France, and Spain. In fact, the last full day I was in Europe, I was on a sightseeing trip in Madrid. I was riding these double-decker tour buses. I got off one bus, so I was waiting to get on another. And then I looked into this park, and I saw this woman dressed up as Minnie Mouse. I knew this had to be a divine appointment. So I approached Minnie. Her real name was Cecilia. She knew a little English, but I still handed her a Spanish tract, and she prayed the prayer of salvation right from the tract. So Minnie Mouse became a new creature. Although I enjoyed traveling around and living by faith, I still had a desire to do music. God brought that back to me in a couple different ways in 2006. I had temporarily moved back to the Fargo-Moorhead area, started attending a church called Springs of Living Water. One day, John Crowder was preaching. I had never seen or heard this guy before. And right in the middle of his message, I was sitting in the front row, he walks up to me and he says, God wants you to start a business that he's already spoken to you about. Well, when I prayed about it, the Lord reminded me of a dream that I had 4 years before. In this dream, I was riding in a car with two other people. We stopped in front of this radio station, and in big red letters, it said WWW. Well, I immediately knew what the dream meant. God wanted me to go on the radio over the internet. But up until 2006, I didn't know how to step out on that. I thought it was too expensive to broadcast online. But after doing some more research, I found out it wasn't that expensive. And not long afterwards, someone gave me an offering of $210. And I used a large portion of that to launch my internet radio station. It's called Signs and Wonders Radio. It's an internet station that plays mostly modern worship music, but I've also recorded myself sharing evangelism tips. The station's been on the air now for a little over 4 years, and it's attracted listeners from over 90 different countries. I give God the glory. Later that year, I got blessed with a MacBook Pro laptop computer. And that totally opened up creative possibilities. It has video making capabilities, so I started making videos to put online. And it also has the capability of creating music, so I started making music again. And it was a few weeks after I got blessed with this computer, I became friends with a minister named John Scotland. How many know who John Scotland is? Has he been here before? Okay. I think he needs to be here. Has anyone told you you look like him? I think from a distance you kind of resemble him a bit. First time I saw John Scotland was in October of 2005. It was in London, Ontario. I originally went up there to do some evangelizing, but there was also a conference going on at Joshua Mills Home Church, and John Scotland happened to be one of the speakers. Well, up until that time, I had seen a variety of preachers. You know, in addition to getting blessed in Toronto, I've been to some of Rodney Howard Brown's meetings. I mean, I've been to a lot of drinking meetings, but I hadn't seen anybody like John Scotland. It was in January of 2007. I was here in the Tampa Bay area, and I found out that John was going to be speaking at a conference at a hotel just 4 blocks from where I was staying. They let me video some of the meetings with my little webcam, and John and I started to get to know each other. And it was a few months later, this idea came to me of producing an album combining samples of his preaching with electronic music produced on my laptop computer. So I emailed an MP3 sample to John. He liked what he heard and he encouraged me to produce the whole album. This is what came out, New Wine Party. You have a copy of this, Pastor? This is for you. I have some additional copies if anybody wants to get one. But so far I've done 4 albums for John Scotland. It's been a blessing to many people. I've received testimonies from people who have been blessed by it. And it also helps bring in provision from my ministry. So again, I just want to encourage you, don't let your gifts be dormant. If you're gifted as a musician, stir that gift up. If you play guitar, play guitar. If you play keyboards, play keyboards. Maybe your talent is writing or sculpting or painting. Whatever your talents are, don't neglect the gift. God can use your gifts to minister to other people. In addition to musical gifts, God has also gifted me with speaking. As I shared before, I've worked as a disc jockey. I was also involved in an organization called Toastmasters. Anybody heard of Toastmasters? Okay. For those of you not familiar with it, Toastmasters is an organization people join to improve their public speaking skills. I was in Toastmasters from 1991 to 1994. It was one of the tools that God used to prepare me to be an evangelist. I started sharing more spiritual things in my speeches. In fact, I remember in October 1992, I did a speech on Bible prophecy. The day after I gave this speech, I was lying in my bed, 3 o'clock in the morning, wide awake. And suddenly I heard this voice speaking to me in my left ear. And at first all I heard was attention, attention, attention. And then this voice spewed all this filthy language. After putting up with it for about 5 seconds, I said, "Satan, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus." And the voice stopped. So let that also be a reminder that we have authority over the devil. Like we were singing earlier, the devil's under our feet. Don't let the devil discourage you from fulfilling the call that God has on your life. And since my primarily spiritual calling is an evangelist, I want to make sure that every person in here is born again. I want to make sure that every person here has an opportunity to receive salvation if you haven't already done so. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Going to church doesn't save you. You can walk in a hospital, that's not going to make you a doctor. You can walk into the White House, but that's not going to make you the President of the United States. Even believing there is a God is not going to gain you entrance into heaven. The Bible says that even the devil believes there is a God, and certainly he's not going to spend eternity in heaven. Now, for the sake of time, I'm not going to do an altar call, but here's a way we can find out if you know the Lord. 1 Corinthians 12:3 says, no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, on a count of 3, I want you to say out loud, Jesus is my Lord. 1, 2, 3. Jesus is my Lord. Praise the Lord. We got a lot of believers here tonight. Now, if you couldn't say that, or if you did say it, or if you did say it but you felt uneasy inside, I would question your salvation. Because going back to Romans 10:9, the next verse says, for with the heart one believes unto righteousness, or right standing with God, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Just saying Jesus is my Lord, that itself is not going to save you. You also have to believe it in your heart. If you haven't done that yet, make a decision to believe that Jesus is your Lord and Savior. Receive the free gift of salvation that God has provided for you. And if you do that and submit your life totally to the Lord, he's going to bless you. He's going to give you, he has a plan for your life. And if you make yourself available, he's going to do things for you that will go beyond your wildest dreams. As it says in Jeremiah 29:11, that God has a good plan for us, a future, a hope, an expected end. Praise the Lord. Pastor?
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Todd. That's a good encouragement to anybody here, because let me say this. And what he was saying is so true, is that if you don't understand it, the things you go through in life and the talents and the things you do, you don't realize, amen, that it's setting you up for the call that God really has for you, amen. Just like Toastmasters, I remember in school I was, I used to be do public speaking all the time. I would go to Tallahassee for the state, congresses, where you debate issues and things of that nature. And so really all along it was, and then all the leadership training I got, without understanding it, and management training is really leading me, amen. That talent was really leading me to use it for the ministry for the Lord, amen. And so I see that, So whatever talent you have, it doesn't matter what it is, you have to see that God's going. It doesn't mean you're going to be necessarily be full-time. You could be. But you use it, amen, for your to minister, amen. So think about what talent do you have? Well, I know I'll just drive a truck. Well, maybe you might be driving, who knows what you may be driving here. But, you can do so many things, amen. They got the truckers for Jesus, all kind of stuff, amen. And there's a lot you can always do with what the Lord has talented you with and given you the talent, amen. But it's up to you to use that talent, amen. Hallelujah. Don't waste it. Don't let it go away. If you've wasted it for years, if you're still breathing, you can still stir it up, amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It doesn't matter if you're 40, 50, 60, 70, but you're still breathing. You can still stir that talent that God has given you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Some of you have talent to do things like to work on electricity and carpentry and all that. Hallelujah. How many of you can use that for the Lord? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Todd. Appreciate that testimony. That was good. Amen. Hallelujah. Come here, Todd. Come on up here. Let's speak a blessing to this young man here. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Stretch your hands this way. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless this man, Lord. Father, we thank you for his call to the ministry, Lord. Father, prosper him in his radio and his music production and, Lord, in his television and internet. Lord, everything, Lord, he puts his hands to, Lord, prospered in the name of Jesus. Father, just like he's prospered, Lord, in bringing souls into the kingdom, Lord, let him be prospered, Lord, in the area of finances also, Lord. And Father, we thank you for that. Lord, bless him. Lord, he is blessed, Lord, but we speak the blessing, the empowerment to succeed over him right now. Lord, we call him blessed and highly favored of you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen.